American troops fighting on the beaches of Normandy. Pinned down by fierce German fire in the first few desperate hours, the long-awaited invasion of Nazi-occupied France has begun. Hello, I'm Herb Wallace.
And I'm Carolyn Cohen, and this is a special broadcast of Channel 1 for Tuesday, June 6, 1944. Battle is taking place in northern France today. It's the first step in what is probably the Allies' final big push to defeat Adolf Hitler and Nazi Germany. Information on the invasion is coming in bits and pieces. Thank you. As you can see, we're getting constant news bulletins.
We've been hoping to get a report from Gerald Abbott in London if the circuit is working. Come in, London.
Yes?
Gerald, you can hear me?
Yes, I can.
Terrific. Tell us what you've learned.
I'm here outside the Houses of Parliament in London. Just hours ago, war correspondents here in England got official word from Allied headquarters that the invasion has begun.
Under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces, supported by strong air forces, began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France.
So this is what all of us have been waiting for so long. It's what the military planners have been calling D-Day, the opening of the so-called Second Front against Hitler. What the statement didn't say was the invasion actually began last night. Here you can see U.S. paratroopers getting a pep talk from General Eisenhower yesterday evening. Afterwards, some 15,000 of them boarded planes for a daring midnight jump behind enemy lines. Early this morning, some of the 5,000 ships that jammed the English Channel opened fire on German gun emplacements on the beach. From the air, several thousand Allied warplanes unleashed their fury on enemy targets below. Most German fighters have been pulled back to defend Germany itself. The hardest work fell to the American, British, Canadian, and other Allied infantrymen. These soldiers, many carrying 70 to 80 pounds of equipment, had to climb down nets from the transport ships into small landing craft. They headed through the rough seas for the five invasion beaches in Normandy. Codenamed Omaha and Utah for the American forces, Sword, Juno, and Gold for the British and Canadians. Our troops had some luck here on Utah Beach. The strong currents pushed them more than a mile off course. So they landed at this area where there weren't very many German defenders. Casualties were described as light. But the story was very different here at Omaha Beach. Troops of the 1st Infantry Division had a terrible time of it. Soldiers were killed by machine gun fire before they could even reach the beach. And those who got to the beach were pinned down by intense German fire. In fact, a half hour after the first wave of U.S. troops landed, the U.S. commanders feared the attack was turning into disaster. But by midday, the U.S. troops had established a foothold in Omaha Beach and have now started moving inland.
Gerald, we've gotten some reports on casualties. Just how bad are they?
Well, Herb, unfortunately, they've been terribly high. What we're hearing is that hundreds of Americans, perhaps several thousand, can be killed or wounded.
Okay, Gerald, thank you very much.
Right.
And when we come back, we'll take a look at some of the strategy involved in the invasion.
Remember, folks, the number of ration points that you'll have to spend next year on canned foods depends on how well you grow your victory garden now. So, see your victory garden through. Eat all the vegetables you can fresh and preserve the rest. You know, last year over 40% of all the vegetables we ate came from victory gardens. So don't forget, all of us can plant the seeds of victory right in our own backyard.
That's my boy who said that.
What made the Allies choose Normandy as the place for the invasion, and where will they head next? Joining us now in our studios, retired Army General Howard Hall, who was severely wounded while commanding an infantry division in the First World War. He now teaches military science. General, what can you tell us?
Well, Carolyn, Herb, first of all, we have to understand that surprise plays a very important element in any military operation. And this has all the aspects of a great surprise. I was interested when I was informed that the invasion was taking place on the beaches of Normandy, when all the military experts, and I'm sure including the Germans, felt that the invasion would take place at Calais, for the very simple reason that there's only less than 20 miles between Calais and the beaches of England.
Well, General, now the troops are ashore. What, in your opinion, what is the commander's in the field's next move?
I think the most important thing is, first of all, we have to secure the beachhead with all kinds of equipment and men. And secondly, we have to take the port of Cherbourg, which is a deep water port, which has piers, which will enable us to bring ashore guns, heavy guns, and tanks, and all kinds of equipment, and millions of men. And then we move on to Paris, and then on to Berlin.
Obviously, our thoughts will be with them. General, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
You know, before the invasion, there were nearly 2 million American troops in England. On a recent visit there, I was able to get to know one of them, Harry Brown, a paratrooper with the 101st Airborne Division. He's a graduate of George Washington High School, a Channel 1 school in Indianapolis, Indiana. Private Brown, so you were drafted right out of high school?
Well, it's sort of funny. After I graduated in 1941, I tried to sign up for the Marines, but they turned me down because I had flat feet. So I worked construction for about 10 months until the Army let me in. We trained at Fort McCall in North Carolina and got over here at the end of last year. We spent some of our time training, a lot of time just waiting around, waiting in lines for chow or waiting in lines for mail.
So do you all talk much about the invasion around here?
Well, they don't tell us too much, but I know we're going to be in the first wave of the invasion. Some of the guys are young like me. A few years ago, we were in high school. Now we're getting ready to invade France. It's scary.
Thank you for talking with us, Private Brown. And good luck.
Thank you, ma'am.
His unit, the 101st Airborne, was one of those that jumped into Normandy last night. Our prayers go out to all of those men.
Yeah, we hope that he and his buddies are all right. And Channel 1's special broadcast on the D-Day invasion will return after this.
Here's Bob Graham of Indianapolis, all set to prove the hand is quicker than the eye. Watch closely now. You may want to mystify your friend. After the string is threaded through the straw, he bends the straw and straightens the string. Next, he clips off the peak of the straw and throws it away. Now, he puts the straws together and pulls the string through. Presto! It's still in one piece. Believe it or not. Say, that's slick. Come on, tell us how you did it, Bob. Well, then at least tell us where we can learn tricks like that. Thanks. Come on, folks, let's look. Well, it's the famous Bike Party and Magic Stunts book. You can get one for 2 Whiz wrappers and 6 cents in coin or stamps. The Whiz Bar is made in the famous Bike Kitchen. It is cellophane wrapped for freshness, supplies quick energy. The world's biggest candy value, only a nickel. Sold everywhere, and boy, it's good.
Here in the United States, word of the invasion came in the middle of the night, and we went out to film some reactions of Channel 1 students.
Well, I think the invasion's great. The war could be over soon. The thing that gets me is most likely it'll be over before I get a chance to fight. I was really looking forward to enlisting on my 17th birthday.
I can't wait for the war to end. I mean, it's been really difficult on my entire family. My brother is part of the war effort, and he's only 18, so I'm constantly worrying about him.
Some reaction from here on the home front. We're also expecting to hear from the White House. Thank you. We're told President Roosevelt himself may even address the nation by radio. We're just starting to get some numbers on American casualties. The news is not good. The figures are from the War Department, which admits the numbers are incomplete. I read here they estimate it to be between 2,000 and 3,000 Americans killed or wounded on Omaha Beach alone.
Herb, I've just gotten some disturbing news as well. Apparently, the young soldier we interviewed, Private Harry Brown, has been killed. The airplane carrying him and 19 others was shot down last night before the paratroopers could jump out.
A sad note on which to conclude our special broadcast of Channel 1 for this June 6, 1944. As you know, these broadcasts are heard by our armed forces around the globe. So before we go, we'd like to pay tribute to the millions of those brave servicemen and women.
And to help us do that, we've invited Jacqueline Clemens, a music student from Overbrook High School, a Channel 1 school in Philadelphia.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly broad stripes and bright stars.
The day after the invasion of France, Allied troops continued their march inland, encountering stiff resistance from the Nazis.
More troops are landing by the hour, and the estimate is that 1 million Allied soldiers will be in northern France by the end of the month.
All right, we don't mean to be rude, but we have to interrupt this broadcast.
Yeah, these two were the anchors on yesterday's D-Day special.
That's right, this is Brandon Douglas.
And this is Julie Gray.
Hey, hello. Thanks for having us, guys. We had a lot of fun. Learned some things.
It was great.
Now, can I take my hair down, though?
Yes, you can.
Actually, I would like to say hello to Richardson High School in Dallas, Texas. My alma mater. I know it's a Channel 1 school. I just wanted to say hello.
All right. Well, we have to take our show back, so I'm Lisa Ling.
And I'm Craig Jackson, and this is Channel 1 for Tuesday, May 24th.
Here it is. Bam! Here it is. One more time.
Yesterday's special edition of Channel 1 was our way of marking the 50th anniversary of D-Day, the invasion of France on June 6, 1944, that many historians say was the turning point of World War II in Europe. Our D-Day special edition included a retired general, played by Harold Russell. Now, I got a chance to talk with him, and I found out that for Harold Russell, D-Day has an unusual significance. As a staff sergeant, you were a demolitions instructor at Camp McCall in North Carolina, and it was there you had an accident and you lost your hands. Could you tell me about that?
On June 6, 1944, we had the problem of running about 2,000 men through an infiltration course using live explosives and live ammunition. I picked up a quarter-pound block of nitrous starch, which is a military explosive. They don't use it anymore. Put a cap in it, and the cap was defective, and it went off. Blew my hands off, knocked me over backwards.
What was it like adjusting?
It's tough. I didn't know what I was going to do with my life. I couldn't see any possibility of anything. And I met a guy named Charles McGonigal. Charlie McGonigal came from California, Sacramento, as a matter of fact. Lost both hands in World War I in France in 1917. Charlie and I became great friends. And I think if it hadn't been for Charlie, that I would have gone nowhere. He's the guy who taught me to shake hands. When you meet somebody, shake hands with them. Say, hi, how are you? I'm glad to meet you. Nice to see you. And you know, it's been the most successful thing I've ever done in my life.
Now, after the injury, you got involved with a film about rehabilitation. How did that come about?
The general who was in charge of the medical corps of the United States Army came to the hospital and said, would you do a service for us? So, you know, of course, you don't say no to a general. Did this Diary of a Sergeant, which was a documentary. It ran 25 minutes about it. It's a guy who lost both hands and what happens to him.
It was a funny feeling coming face to face with gadgets that a child could operate and realizing that I had to learn them all over again.
One of the most famous film directors of that time, Billy Wilder, saw Diary of a Sergeant and cast Harold in a film called The Best Years of Our Lives.
They called me up and said, want to come out and star in a Hollywood picture? I said, you're kidding me. Somebody's putting me on. See you later. And I put the phone down. 5 minutes later, it rang back and said, no, this is no fooling. This is for real. This is a big picture. It's a good chance for you. So, you know, who would say no?
Oh, go ahead, shake, pal. I won't bite you.
The film won 8 Academy Awards. Harold Russell won 2 of them. One for Best Supporting Actor, and a special Oscar for instilling hope and inspiration to returning veterans.
All I've wanted is for people to treat me like anybody else instead of pitying me. I guess it's hard for them to do that.
I was nominated for Supporting Actor, and I said, see, this is great. Imagine getting nominated, holy cats. And I guess the Academy felt the same way because they had a meeting of the board of directors the night before the Oscars. And they voted to give me a special Oscar, and they used it, bringing aid and hope to disabled veterans through the medium of motion pictures.
Well, now you're a motivational speaker, so what do you tell people to motivate them?
I try to tell them, as Charlie McGonigal told me, you know, the life is not easy. There's no rose garden out here. But there's no reason why you can't be happy if you conceive of the right kind of an attitude, a positive attitude. Remember, most of all, there's all kinds of people with all kinds of problems and all kinds of disabilities. But there's none that are insurmountable.
And on June 6th, we'll be talking to some veterans who were there. And we'll take a look at what the battlefields in France look like today. Now, Lisa, you're going to give them the pop quiz?
I am, and it's a level 5 about anachronisms. If you've already studied Shakespeare, you may be familiar with the word anachronism. Webster's defines it as a person or thing that's chronologically out of place. Yesterday, we presented a newscast designed to look like what we might have presented in 1944. But in order to create the most informative presentation, we had to present quite a few anachronisms as well. So your pop quiz question, name at least one anachronism from yesterday's program, and we'll be back with some answers in just a minute. Okay, we're back with some answers to our pop quiz. There were a lot of anachronisms in yesterday's special newscast. 3 of the biggest. Number 1, there was no transatlantic video as we presented it. While there was television, there were even some pictures transmitted across the Atlantic in 1944. There wouldn't have been simultaneous moving pictures here from England. Number 2, we knew too much. Accurate information about the battle was not provided as quickly as we presented it, and military censors at the time would have restricted both the pictures and the reports that came out of Normandy so as to keep valuable battle information from the enemy. And number 3, there was no Channel 1 in-school newscast, because we're only about 4 years old.
Lisa, all those things were anachronisms, but one thing that was completely accurate was the story of Private Harry Brown. He did attend George Washington High School in Indianapolis, Indiana, now Channel 1 school, and he was part of the 101st Airborne, and he did die during the invasion on D-Day. His plane was shot down before he ever got the chance to make a combat jump.
All right, that's it for Channel 1 today, and we hope that you found yesterday's broadcast about D-Day informative.
All right, we'll see y'all later.
Bye-bye, take care.